Hey, folks, Quillikian here, and welcome to another Unity tutorial. We are working on systems for showing selected objects. And right now, let me back up here. I'm going to disable this canvas. Right now, we are set up in such a way that we can mouse over something. It'll highlight green. That's one way of showing a selection. Second thing is it'll show a little square underneath when something is selected. Technically, oh, that's something I should have done last time. Right now, when nothing is selected, where's my little selection indicator? When no item is selected, this thing should hide itself. So it's got an update routine here where it says, hey, if the selected object is not null, then we do stuff. If it is null, what we should say is, I don't want to disable my whole object, because if I disable my object, my update won't run. But we probably shouldn't be visible. So there's a couple of different ways to do it. One way, we could shove ourselves way off the screen, but probably the better way is to say something like, we're going to get component renderer. So renderer, well, and I'm just going to make it, I'm going to disable my old renderer. That way I won't show up on the screen. I'll still be running, but I won't show up. And of course I have to do the invert over here where if there is a selection, we want to do true. So what we'll do is when we hit play now, oopsie daisy. Oh, right. Of course I don't have a renderer. Get component in children. Get component children, because my selection indicator itself doesn't have a renderer. It has a child quad in there. So we just want to turn the renderer on and off there, which I guess means I could disable that whole child thing. But there we go. So now when nothing is selected, it goes and hides. So two ways, we've shown two ways of selecting an object now. When you mouse over an object, it can change its color. The other thing you might do, like right now we're just changing the color of the material, but you could also have more than one material. And you could swap between the two. You could have maybe a ghostly version of the material, or a material with a different shader where it like sparkles or lights itself up, or I don't know, does a bunch of different things. But you can change the material in some fashion to show that it's selected. We've got this little object that automatically attaches itself and scales to the object to show that it's selected. And you can futz around that to make it a lot better. You could use a 3D object here. It is a 3D object, it's a quad, but it's flat, right? You could replace that with some sort of box or square or something. Actually, tell you what, let's do it. It's really easy. Let's replace, right now, we've got a quad in here. Where is it? Oh yeah, it's currently a little bit invisible. Let me just shove it over. There we go. It's invisible when the program is running, but right now it should be visible so that we can mess with it. And let's go and take this quad. I'm gonna disable the quad graphic, the quad, and replace it with a cube. Boom, so we have a cube here. I'll give it the same material, actually. Boom. Although, and then it becomes really important. I got to fix this material so that it is transparent. Actually, cutout will work even better here. There we are. So now the material is properly transparent. And I take this cube and I'm just going to raise it up so that with the origin of the parent, it'll be the bottom middle of this cube right over there. Which means that now when I hit play, it's putting the cube in place. Oh yeah, it's gonna scale. It's scaling the parent, which means it is changing the position. Oh, and we've got a collider on this, which we don't want. I wanna remove that. Because we're scaling this, including in the Y, which is what we want to do, but is moving things in a slightly unexpected fashion. I don't know. Do you know what I'm saying? Because this Y is 1, when we scale the parent up, this Y, I mean, it's still a 1, but it's a 1 in local space, so... How do I want to... What's the best way to fix that, actually? I mean, this would not... It would not... The cube would not float if it was in the ground like that. And it's not. It's always going to be... Its midpoint is always going to be in the middle on the plane, because it's set to 0. If this were a cube model with its origin properly set to the bottom, we'd be okay. But right now we lead to kind of funny weirdness. I guess the thing to do, it's a little bit hackish, but I could change the Y in here, assuming I know it's a cube, which I guess would be fine. Oh, actually, I could just be centered. That's true. I was setting it to zero. I was forcing it to zero in the Y direction because I always wanted my flat square to be on the ground. But in this case, I actually want my cube to be properly centered on the object. There we go. Easy solution. Beautiful. So now, whenever we're selecting something, we've got it boxed around. Personally, I think this looks a little bit silly. I think it looks a lot sillier than our flat version, but it is a very, very legitimate way to go about things. And the extent, because we're not using the diameter here, because we're not using this diameter, this extra times 125 isn't factoring it in. We're not using this diameter at all. Let's just multiply this times 1.1f. Let's get an extra 10% bigger. We'll still center it correctly, but we'll make our actual box just slightly bigger than the thing we're surrounding. Nice. I was noticing just that Z fighting on the bottom here, the Z fighting for the indexes. And there, that looks nice. Oh, it casts a shadow, which we could turn off. That's just something in the renderer of this. We say, you don't receive or cast shadows. That's probably better for this. You'd probably also want a self-illuminating material so it glows a little bit better and does different things like that. Anyway, enough screwing around with the selection indicator. I'm going to go and disable this. Boop, like that. And we're going to hit play. So if you go and you download the files, I'm going to have one download for the first episode, which is still going to have the flat version of the indicator. And in the second episode, you're going to have this sort of 3D version of the indicator. So if you want to look and compare, you can see them both. So, but what I want to do in this one is I want to have a GUI version of our selection box. This is the sort of thing that can come in handy, well, in all kinds of different games, for different reasons. You might not want the selection indicator to be a 3D thing in the 3D world. You might want it to hover as part of the UI. And so the idea being that as the object moves, this little thing, moves to highlight the other object. And ideally, scales correctly. In this case, it's really interesting. Given the orientation of both objects, the selection box should be just about the same, even though these objects are completely different size. But it's very easy to imagine, especially if an object gets really quite far away. Let's take the big object here. Let me go back into, say, top view, and take this object and move it far away. Now all of a sudden, even though it's a bigger object in reality, the selection box for it should actually be quite a bit tinier. It's easy to imagine that we actually want the selection box to be about, say, that big, which is not big enough for this guy over here. So how do we get that to work? At that point, we want the selection box to be sized based on how large something appears on the screen, appears on our specific viewport. So let's work on that. First of all, one of the things that I don't like is right now we're just scaling the image directly, right? Which leads to it looking a little bit funnier. It would look nice if our little image sprite were actually a 9-slice image. So what's a 9-slice image? First, let's turn the canvas back on. So our image here, we can say, instead of being image type simple, we can say it's a sliced image. This image doesn't have a border, it tells us. So let's set a border. So this is a sprite in single sprite mode. It's not a multiple sprite. It's not polygon or anything like that. It's a single sprite. We can still go into the sprite editor and we can still adjust this. Normally you're used to setting these boxes if you're working with multiple sprites, because you're sort of drawing these little squares around each sprite. But here what we're doing is we're setting a bit of a border. And what I'm defining here is I'm saying this is the center of the image, and these are the four corners of the image, and these are the four sides of the image. And I'm going to apply this. And because I've done that, we now have our image here can be in the slice mode or 9-slice mode. And what it does is it doesn't scale the corners anymore. The middle would still get scaled and the sides still get stretched. The corners don't though. And it means that your actual graphic, the corners always look the same size. They don't stretch and they don't look weird. And it actually, I think, looks quite nice for something like this, right? So ideally we'd get something, kind of like that over here. And over here we'd want something that looks kind of like that. Can we achieve that? This also looks really good, I think. If you're making like a spaceship game where you're like sitting in the cockpit or something like that, then it would be quite nice to have something that sort of, is like a HUD, right? A heads-up display like that. I think that would look quite nice. The other thing you can do, attach to this image, it would be quite easy to go and get another UI element, say a text element over here, and we would want this text element anchored to like this, and whatever the width of the image is, so it's, in this case it's 110, we would want, no, not the width, the X position. Because alternatively, we could anchor it to the right side, but then, yeah, it anchors that way, and that's not an alignment thing. So we anchor it to the right. Oh, that's right. No, we set our... We anchor it to the right-hand side, and then we set our position to be offset by our width. There we go. That looks good. And then no matter what our parent does, so if our parent gets wider or thinner, our text is still stuck over on the right-hand side of it. And then we end up doing something like, some cool info. We could bring in a different font, but a lot of times you can't distribute fonts. So I'll just keep with Arial. But let's go and change the color to, like, bright green, you know, like one of those. Oh, that's not good. I don't know, something like this. It was too hard to see on the white. You know, this is like unit name, distance, threat level, yada, yada, yada. Go ahead and just embiggen this. Actually, I guess we could have anchored. Oh, that's probably better. Anchor this way. And then again, offset you by 160. And then center you vertically this way. There we go. And then if I take the parent and I resize, there we go. It's always going to be centered. That looks, see, that looks nice, right? Nice-ish. Ignore my horrible colors and lack of ability to do anything visual. But then we've got this cool little UI system where when you have a unit selected, the square highlights it, and then you get the info next to it. It's awesome! And what's cool about, what will be cool about this, it doesn't do it now, but as we rotate our screen around, we want it to stay relevant. So, how do we get this? How do we get the correct size of the object? Your first pass, and this is why I actually got sort of stumped on this a while. I finally tweeted yesterday and was like, oh, cool, I got this figured out. Right? We have code that does something relatively similar. Our selection indicator over here, if we turn this back on and then we hit play, right? Our selection indicator sizes itself based on the object. That's cool. And it uses renderer, the renderer's bounds to figure out where it should be centered and how big it should be. And that's really good. The renderer bounds are always in world units. But what we could do, if you look at this box, I wonder if I can just move things in such a way that makes it a little bit clearer. Because that's going to be quite small on the screen for you guys. Un momento. Let's take our big cube and let's bring it closer to the camera. And then over to here. There we go. And then I can take my little image here, which I should call the 2D, or how about the UI selection indicator? I like that. Indicator. So I'm going to rename it, and then we're going to find it, and then I'm just going to move it to something like this. And like this. This looks like the appropriate size of square for that, right? Well, what's interesting, if I go and I mouse over, oh, right, and there's the little margin. So let's account for that, a little bit of a margin around it. It should be kind of obvious to you, if you look at like where the top of this is aligned and the top of this box is aligned, they sort of match up. This topmost point is equal to the topmost point of this visually. And the bottommost point is equal to the bottommost point of this. And the rightmost point and the leftmost point and that. And the way we do it, basically, what we're going to do is we're going to look at all eight corners of this box, right? This box, again, has been artificially sort of inflated in our code. It's 10% bigger than it needs to be. But you can imagine that this box is exactly the same. When renderer.bounds, when we get a renderer bounds, that's what this box is. It's defining in the world where this object sits. And if we look at all four corners of it, and we transform each of those, all eight corners of this cube, and we take all eight of these corners of this cube, and convert them from world space into the viewport space, right? The screen space over here. And we figure out which one of these eight points has the highest Y and the lowest Y, and which one of them has the biggest X and the smallest X. Well, that will define our top left and bottom right corner, or the other way around. I guess it's more like bottom left corner and top right corner, because we'll know that this corner here is the smallest screen X and smallest screen Y, whereas this corner over here is the largest screen X and the largest screen Y. And then we can figure out how to make a nice little box that surrounds our thingy. Let's do that. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a new script over here, and I guess I'm going to call it UI selection indicator. That works fine. Sure. Let's open up UI selection indicator. And we're going to borrow a little bit of code from our selection indicator over here. Mono behavior. There we go. We're going to borrow a wee bit of code. Basically, we're going to do the same thing where we grab a copy of the mouse manager. And then we're going to, well, we'll grab this update as is and we'll trim a bunch of stuff out. Right? And we're just going to say, hey, do we have something selected or not? And if we have something selected, then we're going to make sure to position ourselves correctly. If we don't have anything selected, we're going to hide ourselves. How do we hide ourselves? Well, for this, this is a UI element, which means we need to include Unity engine.ui. And that means we can now get component of type image. And we have that, right? Our UI selection indicator has an image, so we could turn that off. Oh, but if we do that, what about our text? I guess we could grab both. It starts to be a wee bit awkward. No, that's okay. You know what? That's fine. Actually, you know what the best way to do this would be? Oh. Would be if we made an image as a child of this, and this image was our selection box UI, and we made sure this image was always stretched to be the full size, and then we took the image from our own and just removed it. So now our actual UI selection object doesn't do anything. It's got a rect transform. It actually doesn't even need a canvas renderer component at all. It's just, this is basically an empty game object. It's an empty game object. It has a rect transform instead of a transform because it's part of the UI. And it's got a couple of children. One child is the image. Boop, boop. One child is the text. Boop, boop. And because of anchors, they both properly scale the way that you would expect. Awesome. So then what we can do is this. Instead of get component image, I don't even need to include UnityEngine.ui. It actually turns out to not be required. It will be. So I'm lying to you there. But what we can do is something like for I is less than this.transform.num, or was it child count? So we're going to loop through each of our children and go this.transform.getChild of index I. Dot set active. Oh, we gotta go game object dot set active. False. So if we don't have anything selected, we're gonna turn all our children off. And if we do have something selected, then we're gonna turn all our children on. There. As long as we ourselves aren't rendering, we don't have to do anything to ourselves. That way we are always running. We're never disabled. We always run so we can check to see the moment something becomes selected. Boom! Awesome. Love it. What else do we have to do? Well, then we have to scale ourselves appropriately. So how are we going to do that? So again, we're going to look at the render box. We have to look at this render box. If I mouse over here, look at all 8 points, all 8 corners of this box and find and convert it to screen space coordinates and then find the min, max, etc., etc., etc. So that's what we're going to do. So what we're going to do is over here, We're gonna set up an array. So right, we'll have an array of vector threes because we need, and it's gonna be an array of 8 of them. Boom, boom. Corners? Yeah, like corners. And it's gonna be a new vector three array of size 8. And then for all 4 corners, we're simply going to loop through each other. So we're gonna say corner, the first corner, which is corner 0, of course. We're going to take the camera.main. We're going to take our main camera. I guess it might not be a bad idea at this point to say, because imagine we might have multiple cameras. We want to make sure to pick the right one. So let's do something like, the camera. And assume we've got some system for setting it. In this case, we'll just set it to camera.main. .main. Totally cool, right? So camera. Or the camera. Is equal to something. And it's got a function called world2screenPoint. It takes a world coordinate, which is a vector 3, and turns it into a screen point, which for some reason returns a vector 3, even though it could have been a vector 2. The reason it's returning a vector 3, even though the depth component, the z component, means nothing in this case. The reason it does that is because these functions existed before vector 2. Vector 2 was only introduced when the 2D engine stuff in Unity, I want to say 4.5 was added, whereas this is a function that's existed since basically the start of Unity. So we have to give it a point. Now, what is the first corner of our of our box, of our bounding box. What is the first corner of it? Right? So we're going to be feeding this in some sort of vector 3 that represents the first corner of our bounding box. And then we're going to be converting it to world screen. And then that's what we're storing in here. So these corners, actually, this should be screen space corners. There we go. A bit more verbose, but it works. So this is going to be the corner in world space. And we get that very much like over here. We've got these bounds. So this is the space occupied by the object's visuals in world space, defined as a center point plus some sort of offset from that center point. So our first corner is going to be, I call it big bounds because that was a leftover, but yeah, sure, big bounds is fine. Because again, right now we're grabbing the first renderer. It's entirely conceivable that instead of grabbing the first renderer, you might want to grab the first renderer's bounds and then loop through all the other renderers that are in there and add them all up together. But in this case, we only have one renderer, so we're going to be okay. So new vector. So the X component is going to be the bounds. It's going to be the center point of this bounds plus the extents in the X. So size in X is the total side from, say, the left side to the right side, the total difference from the far left to the far right. That is your size. Extents is half of that because it's basically from the center point to an edge. How far is that? So that's the extents. We could have also just put in size.x divided by 2, but that would be a little bit silly. So that's our X part. And then we'll do our Y part, which is going to be the center.y plus the extents.y. And then we do the Z part. Same thing as here. So that's our first corner. Then we go comma, and we add in the next one. Or not comma here, derp. How come I'm getting an error? New vector 3. Am I... There should not be a comma there. There we go. Okay, there we go. So that's corner number one. And for the sake of argument, I'm going to go and shrink this down to a single line. We're going to need to restore our screen size to something a little bit more reasonable. That's the Y. And then there's the Z. And then the closing of our new vector 3. And then the closing of the to world point. Boom. Shrink this down a lot so you can actually see it. And then I'm going to go and make this happen 8 times. That is 7. So first corner, second, third, fourth. I know, off by 1. But there we go. So that's all 8 corners. So the first one is the one where you're adding the X, the Y, the Z. The second corner is going to be where you add the X and the Y, but you're subtracting Z. That's another corner. And then the next one is going to be where you're adding the X, subtracting the Y, adding the Z. And the last corner of this side is going to be the one where you're adding the X, subtracting the Y, subtracting the Z, like that. And actually, I think it'll be a lot easier if I delete these, because the second batch of 4, 5, 6, 7 is going to be exactly the same as the first set, but with all the X's being negative. So this, what we're doing is we're grabbing all 8 corners of the bounding of the renderer's bounding box in world space, and we are converting all 8 of those corners into some sort of screen space version of it. So we've got all 4 of those corners, and then all we want to do at that point is we want to figure out, out of all these, what's the tallest X, or what's the highest Y and the lowest Y, the highest X, the lowest X. So we could actually, we could create it as a create in a few different ways to represent it. I guess we could probably just make a rectangle at this point. Right? I don't know. Let's tell you what. Let's make a couple lanes. So we're going to have min x, which we should actually grab from the first point. So let's assume, because rather than set any sort of value, we're going to set min x is equal to screen space corners 0 dot x, min y, and then it's going to be max and max, y and y. So, I mean, we're going to start from assuming that our center point is all the things, which is clearly not going to end up being that way, but then we can loop through the other four, or the other eight corners, or rather, I should say, the other seven corners, right? Yeah. So, what I can do is, 4, I is equal to, it'll actually start at 1, and it has to be less than 8. So this will go from 1 to 7, and that's going to be fine. So we skip the first one, because we've already, like, sort of guessed from that. And then we can say something like, if screen space corner I dot x is less than min x, then this becomes the new min x. And the same thing for y. And there's ways to shorten it. You can use like a min function or different things like that. I don't know, but this is going to be fine. Y. And then sort of the same thing, but the inverse. Because if it's bigger than our current maximum, then this becomes the new maximum. So at this point, we find the... Okay. For each of the eight corners of our renderer's world space bounding box, convert those corners into screen space. Now find the min, max, x, and y of these screen space corners. So now that we have all that, we can set the position of our UI selector. It's pretty easy. Let's see here. So this should all be in world space, right? Or sorry, this should all be in screen space. I think so. Let's take a moment here and roll the screen point. Yep, that's fine. That's fine. That's fine. So if we were to take our own position, so we have rect transform. We have a rect transform. Get component rect transform because we're UI unit element. So with a rect transform, we can set our position to be equal, I guess, just to the minimum corner. Actually, I guess we don't really... No, we'll need the rect transform. That's fine. Because we can say rect transform.position is equal to a new... And I believe this actually does want a vector too. I'll convert from one to the other. Where let's put ourselves at the minimum corner. So we're at the minimum x and minimum y, y. And let's see what that does for us. Let me take the selection indicator. Oops, we've got some conversions we have to do. And let's just set our size to like something relatively tiny, so it'll be easy to work with. And let's see these missing casts here. Float to an int. What am I trying to convert to an int? Ah, these are supposed to be floats. Boop, 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 boop. I should get rid of all those. Excellent. Now, if I hit play, that'll disable itself. And if I put it somewhere, is the bottom left corner of this thing where we expect it to be? First of all, if this just got set to position 0, 0. No, okay, so it's not anchored where we want it to start off with. So let's anchor it. There we go. So if we feed it a position of 0, 0, it should be in the bottom left corner. So now if we hit play, that looks, the bottom left corner of this square, ignore the 3D version. Well, actually not really ignore the 3D version, but ignore the fact that the 3D version is in biggin by 10%, right? If we remove float, padding. So this is my 3D version from before. We're going to force the padding to be normal. So we're just going to multiply it by padding number over here. So now the 3D bounding box should be exactly tight to the actual render bounding box, which means if we look at the bottom of this box over here, it is pretty much aligned properly to the corner. And the leftmost point of the box over here seems to be in line to the left. Again, the bottom left corner of our pop-up should be aligned to the very leftmost point of our 3D box and the bottommost point of the 3D box. That looks pretty good. So now we want to make sure the top right corner of our UI box is aligned as far to the right and as far to the high as it can. How do we align the top right corner? The bottom left corner, we can just set the position. The top right corner, we actually just have to scale our UI component to be correct. So we've got a, is it local scale that I want to set? No, it's not the scale, it's the size delta. Because if we look at, where the hell is my thingy? Right over here. Our UI selection thing. We don't want to mess with the scale. The scale is weird. It's the size here that we want to change, right? The width and height over here, this size, that we want to change so the box is correct. And how, what's the size? This is a new vector too. The width is equal to max x minus min x, and the height is equal to max y minus min y. So now if we go and hit play, oh, our UI box is good. Let's turn off the 3D box. 3D box, go away. Actually, let's rename this one to 3D selection indicator. Boom. And do this. Bam, 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 bam. I am super happy. I am really super mega happy. That looks pretty good. And we can confirm if we move the camera around, because that's a good test. Let's say the camera gets like rotated. How do I want to do this? Change it to maybe the camera's looking straight down, for example, on this scene. So we're going to bring it, so the camera's over things right now. We're going to have it look it more down. Okay, that's way too high. We'll do something like this, and then we hit play. Does this still look right? It's a little weird. Why does it get so much extra space down here? I'm not 100% convinced that we've done it quite right here. Let me try a completely different angle. What if we're looking at the scene directly from the side? So we can do this, and then I'm going to run a rotate at 90 degrees in the Y, and then move it over this way. So now we're looking at the scene from the side. How does this look? Okay, no, I think we're all right. That definitely looks, that looks pretty damn good. And remember, this is part of the GUI system, which has all sorts of other advantages. It's a really good way. First of all, you don't have to worry. Here, there's an interesting point. If I do this, I'm technically highlighting the thing in the background, but you see the GUI element, because of the way it works, is in the far foreground. Now, you can do that with 3D objects as well, but it's not quite the same. Let's flip this. Let's make the 3D indicator active and turn off the UI version of it. So this is a 3D indicator, right? So that's a 3D box that is around the object. And you can see that it's being occluded in part by the thing in the foreground. Again, you could change this quite easily by custom shaders, by, you could actually have two cameras that render things in one on top of the other. And you can have these highlighted elements only be rendered by one camera, the one that's rendered second. So it's always going to be in front. There's a bunch of different ways that you can do that with this thing. Basically you do a custom shader that doesn't write to the Z buffer, for example. But yeah, so I mean, that's okay. And I don't think you would normally use this. And certainly a game that you play from this angle, I think this would be a really dumb way to make selection boxes. On the other hand, if you're playing a game from this angle, and again, it's good for those first person-y sort of spaceship games, this UI pop-up is fantastic. And again, it doesn't have to be limited to just this border and then text. What if you had little icons on there to show, you know, the affiliation flag, right? The flag of the space empire that this thing belongs to. You could have that graphically. It's just an icon. It's just part of the text. And it's a lot, it's going to be a lot less fiddly than trying to get a quad in world space to show up the right way and not be hidden by something. This will always be the topmost element without you having to mess with shaders. I think this is quite powerful and very, very, very handy and useful. And of course, I mean, we just have static text here, right? That doesn't update, but you can easily have a script that changes that text, that sets the things, and does awesome things with it. So I'm really happy that I, like, finally, I, I never got this in my head. I was like, how do we get, there must be something. And it is actually a little disappointing that Unity does not have a built-in function that tells you, that converts this sort of, like the renderer.bounds is great, but I'm surprised that there's not a version of it that tells you like renderer bounds in screen space, which is really what we just wrote. And you can make that function generic. You could make this function, actually. Let's see how we do this. So obviously we wouldn't want ints. We'd want something, some sort of function, you know, in some piece of code somewhere. It's a static function that I guess returns, I mean, you can return a rect, right? Hold on, I actually gotta look up a reference to something. Unity rect, not rect transform, just rect. Hashtag rect. Right, rect.minmax. I remember seeing that when I was looking up some of the references. So we want to return a rect that says something like renderer, it's a function called renderer bounds in screen space. And it takes in a renderer called R. And so what it's going to do, it's going to do all of this. Boom. In here. It needs big bounds. Oh. So big bounds is simply going to be r.bounds. And then what we need to do is call this function. Rect visual bounds. It's not really bounds, it's visual rect, I guess, because otherwise I might get confused, which is equal to this function, and we're going to feed in mm.selectedObject.getComponentInChildrenRenderer. That's the renderer we're going to pass to this thing. This is going to do exactly the same thing as we had before. It's just going to be as a standalone function. It needs to return a rect, which is going to be return new rect dot min max rect. I don't know why it's not auto-completing. Which needs the min x. Oh, it's not a constructor. That's why. It's a static function that will return a rect. It needs min x, min y, max x, max y. There we go. Just a very convenient way to get the information back. And then this becomes a little simpler because the bottom left corner is just the visual rect dot x, I think. I'm pretty sure that's true. Is it going to be x or x min? Right, I guess x min. X is probably going to be the centered bit, so we don't want that. We want visual rect dot y min. So it's exactly the same thing as we had before, but passing a single rect back is a lot simpler. And then here, instead of having to do any math, we say visual rect dot width, visual rect dot y. And then if we run it, we can confirm that we have broken it completely. Oh right, the camera. So instead of saving it here, we'll just say camera dot the camera is that. We could also maybe require that you pass a camera to here. That might be good. But for now, we're going to be fine. You can always customize that pretty easily. We'll hit play and confirm that it doesn't work. Why is the height off? The height's double what it should be. Everything else is fine. Literally. Well, that's really weird. And clearly the problem is that I'm using, oh, not dot y. Dot height. I was using visual rect.y when it should have been dot height. But there we go. Now we have exact code that works exactly the same as before, but this function is just a nice generic static function that you can call anywhere. You can develop some library, some utility library, like one static class that you just keep around for all your projects that has functions like this, for example. So you can just always call this, you know, you call it like my utility dot render bounds in screen space. So you pass it a renderer of an object and then it does this. And then you might actually go through all the work of saying, well, instead of passing a renderer, what if you pass a game object? And we'll go through and add up all the bounds from all the things and, you know, get the full total, which would be damn handy. But for now, this is going to be fine. Also, there's probably a bunch of different ways to optimize this. One of the things that would minimize a little bit of the garbage collection, because every time this runs, it will create an array of 8 vectors, which will get recycled, like garbage collected, and then recreated over and over. I don't know if C# would optimize around that. It might, but one way to avoid, it would, because this is a new allocation. One way to avoid that is you could do you could have it static, right? You could have this be a static and check to see if it's null and then initiate it once and then that's it, because this does run every single frame. So if you're really concerned about, you know, speed, so you can do something like static that, if this is equal to null, then we instantiate it. There you go. So then we only ever have to create one array of these vectors. They get reset. All 8 of these subvectors get changed every time, which means you don't have to worry about stale data being around. Then we don't have that array being instantiated every single frame, then also garbage collected, and then it still works just fine. So technically that's a little bit more performant. There's probably other ways of doing it, because there's a lot of stuff being called here, right? There's a lot of functions being called over and over and over. Maybe there's a way to make it fastest. Probably it's going to still be pretty damn fast, though. Especially since you're only doing this once per frame, right? You don't run this for every single object. You only run this for the one object you have selected. And I guess it's relatively straightforward math. It's just a little bit of multiplication and addition. Even in within those functions, that's all that's happening. You know, and they're probably running it through a matrix that is improving the speed a little bit too. So it, I don't know, seems to be pretty fine. And I think this is swell. I think it looks great. And of course, it'll look even better if you feed it some better graphics and use a better font than this and maybe a bit of a background color. I don't know. I'll leave that one as an exercise to you guys. Send me some screenshots, especially on Twitter, if you make something cool with this. Thanks for watching, folks. See you next time.